Well, if I could have everybody take their seats for our next presentation. But first, I have yet another thing to throw out into the audience and hopefully not cause a liability issue. So for this, I'm sorry? Yeah, well, that's true. So, what hotel was there a chandelier hit in? No, that was not the Wharton Park. There we go, I heard the Hyatt. Where?
You're gonna have to come.
Yeah, you're gonna have to come get it. This one's metal. Alrighty, well, just a couple of announcements. You probably already have a t-shirt. I hope you do, because the line's really long. But those and bags of crap will be available for a donation and registration tomorrow. And also, thank you, everybody, for complying with our mask policy to keep everybody safe here at Shmoocon. So, really appreciate that. Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Nicole Schwartz, who will be speaking on Ya Got Trouble and SLSA May Help.
All right, so me. I only have 20 minutes. This is going to be super high level. The slides and everything will be up on my website, my social medias. Find me in the bar or around about to ask more questions. And yes, all of the titles are musical songs. And I'm not going to sing this to you because then you would all leave. I am married to him, and I work at a company that securely builds your open source. And I run the Diana initiatives. I help channel the chaos over at SkyTalks. I talk about DEI, DevOps, Agile, all of those things. And hey, look, it's the second time today we get to see this live. So, greater than 50% of code in software today is third-party services, usually open source. It could also be proprietary because a lot of people buy something from someone and then package it in and then sell it to somebody else. That makes things really appealing targets. If I can compromise one thing, get a ton of people, Yahtzee, right? So the Okta thing, the PyTorch, Torch Triton thing, you know, the Christmas present none of us want. It wasn't as bad as last year's Christmas present, but you know, whatever. These are supply chain attacks, specifically software supply chain attacks. Nicole, what the heck is a supply chain attack? Well, supply chain for a real thing, like maybe our badges or whatever, you have stuff that has to be created, whether it's, you know, materials, minerals, you have to manufacture that into a widget, take the widgets, assemble them, test them, ship them somewhere, and then sell them to somebody. And last couple of years, there's been shortages of everything because of supply chain issues. Exact same thing applies to your software. You're picking up this from here and that from there, and you're building it over here at your GitLab or your GitHub or, you know, whatever CICD platform you're using it on, the Docker and the Kubernetes, and then you're packaging it up and then you're putting it in something, and then one of your suppliers is putting it in something. That is your supply chain. There is this whole cascade of things end to end that tons of people are touching, and anything that goes wrong in there affects everything downstream. So the government noticed. Oops. They put out executive order 14028, and it was clarified by memorandum M2218. I don't find that exciting reading. Some of my friends do. The key things out of there is June 11th, agencies shall collect attestation letters for critical software. Meaning if you touch critical software for the government, you're going to have an attestation letter. September 13th, agencies shall collect attestation letters for all the other software. Attestation letter? I'm going to stop saying that word because it's hard to say. They're documents. Thank you. The documents are talking about what went in to what process, that process used what, and what was the outcome. So it's talking about that entire process in a single document. And you're all shitty at documentations. So they're basically telling you, please document your shit now. This is going to be cascading. So it's going to start here, and then the suppliers of the suppliers, the suppliers of the suppliers' suppliers, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It is going to spread through the ecosystem. So even if the June and September dates are not going to affect you, you will eventually be affected. And if you don't get hit by the U.S. government stuff, Japan and the EU both have things that are currently coming. coming about. We heard reference to the EU one earlier. They aren't quite as finalized yet as the U.S. government one, but you can just expect these are just going to keep coming because the attacks keep coming. And I forgot to start my timer. Shit. Anyway, so what is it they want from us? Well, an S-bomb, which we've all been generating for a while, hopefully, either in SPDX, which is the ISO standard, or Cyclone DX. A lot of people haven't really figured out what to do with the S-bombs, but that's a whole different issue. You should go watch all of Alan Friedman's talks. Anyway, they also want you to do secure software development. This one is a little bit more in-depth. You have to follow the NIST guidance for Secure Software Development Framework, or the SSDF, and the NIST Software Supply Chain Security Guidance. Now, if you are in a regulated industry, if you've done your ISO 27001, your SOC 2, PCI, Security Standards Council stuff, this isn't going to be completely novel to you, and we're going to talk more in detail about what they want later. You're going to be partially there. You're going to run into problems, however, if you have exempted your developers from anything. You're going to run into problems if you've only applied to parts of your organization, or if you've constantly had exceptions here, exceptions there. The newest element is the software attestations. That's the document I talked about. And the cool kid on the block right now is SLSA, Supply Chain Levels for Software Artifacts, that's recommending in total. So, SLSA, what? It's supposed to be an approachable ladder of prioritized prescriptive practices, and it's going to help you get towards doing the SSDF. And why is it trying to help you make this easy? Well, if you've read the SSDF, they tell you what you need to do, but not how you need to do it. So for any of us who like to go and go down the rabbit hole, it's going to take you a long time to work through something that gives you kind of a lot of room to move. So SLSA was like, we're just going to tell you what to do, and then you can decide you don't like it and deviate from it. You do not need to comply with SLSA to do SSDF. But it would probably be good to read it first, get some ideas, and then decide if you're going to, like, swirl off and do something different. But at least you're going to get closer to it at that point in time. So, key things about it. It was started by Google. It's now an industry collaboration. There are working groups for different elements of it. There are not a lot of people in those working groups. You should participate in these. You just have to show up to the meetings and talk, and then help with some documentation, and then help define things. Why is that important? Well, if you have a certain thing in mind for the way that you work, and everybody currently on the committee maybe works in only these two different ways, they're not going to consider that. So when they write this regulation, you're going to be like, how does this help me? I don't even understand how that applies to me. That's because you didn't participate. So kind of the earlier talk was Avis Amazing, and say you need to be participating in open source since everyone is using open source. So anyway, it's in version 0.1, it's a baby, and it's designed to help you reduce your attack surface on everything you're doing, or at least be aware of what is in there. And so reducing tampering by making a static, here is what happened when. There's multiple levels to it. Level 0, YOLO! Level 4, I have done all of the things, and this is done on an ephemeral container, and everyone's got MFA, yada, yada, yada. Why is this important? It just gives you a common terminology. I can be like, hey, I'm SLSA 2, you're SLSA 2, I know exactly what you're doing, what I'm doing. Interesting thing about this, you have to comply with everything in the level to be that level. So even if you're doing everything in level 2 and a couple things in level 3, you are not level 3. So what are the requirements in SLSA? It's 4 areas, but one of them is super vague and not actually defined. Again, join the working group if you want to help with that. Source. This is specifically about your proprietary source. They recommend, you know, really useful things like two-person code review. Build is everything that happens to make the output. All of the components. What is the image? What is the process? Do you allow user inputs? You shouldn't, or if you are, they should only be at the beginning of the process, can't get transmitted, blah, 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 blah. Anyway, how did you build the output? And what was the output? So somebody could verify, did I get the thing the way that it was supposed to be? Or did someone tamper with it? Provenance, that's the attestation thing we keep saying. Did you have the metadata to say what the pieces that went in, what the process they went through, and what the outcome was? That should be stored and available to people. Shouldn't be changeable. And then and they also have this nice little calming part, which is like, follow best security practices and don't have too many admins. It needs to get way more specific. It is not a security scanner. It's not going to find your CVEs. It's not going to find any passwords you put in there. It's not going to prevent typo squatting. But it's going to be really useful for you to look back and say, when did something change? This one item that was in there, how many versions of my code were impacted? So going through this entire process isn't going to make you more secure, although maybe you'll find some policy things that you're missing and be like, oh, yeah, let's do that. So that may help. But it is going to give you a better idea of what is my risk profile, what things can get at me, and can I at least record it so I have a chance of noticing that something's happened. Anyway, definitions. Artifact is like their word thing. If you see artifact, it basically refers to anything. It's data. It's a file. It's a tar. It's an image for a Docker. So whenever you see artifact, it doesn't really mean anything, unfortunately. Attestation, specifically document. Provenance. It's talking about where something came from the whole process, the bits, the process, the outcome. And then verification, the VSA, verification summary attestation. That's where you get a chance. Now, here's the thing. These are not unique. I can say, I am going to write a VSA on this particular piece of software and say, I think it's SLSA level 3. Somebody else can write one and say, well, I think it's level 1. Then we can have a fight about it, and somebody can be like, well, I believe them, not Nicole, so I'm going to go with them. And that's fine. This is actually hopefully going to start a conversation about why did they think it was that, why did she think it was that. Now, here is the interesting thing. This is not transitive. So if somebody says that is level 3, that does not mean every component that went into it had to be level 3. So this is a common misperception. You can include a Docker image that you picked up from the internet somewhere, level 0, use that to build your components, and still create a level 3, because you did all of the correct steps. So don't believe that everything that went in was safe. Isn't this SLSA? No. The first part, all the bits, yes, that's SLSA. However, we've added on the build process and the outcome parts. There have been some discussions on both sides about, like, should these merge? And that would be nice, because that would be one less thing. But we're not there yet. No, it's not another scanner that you need to triage the output from. Yay! One less thing to do, right? Anyway, ideally you're doing a lot of this stuff already. And going through the SSDF will just give you a chance to be like, yep. Oh, shit. I guess I should be doing that. And you may need to produce some extra output, but I'm going to tell you why that's not such a big deal in a minute. All right, so I mentioned the SSDF, and I said it was really broad earlier. Well, I'm at least going to give you the four areas. Prepare the organization. This is stuff about, like, your whole company, not just the devs. Telling them about, this is how we do software development. This is who's allowed to touch stuff. This is where annual training stuff comes in. Protecting the software, producing well-secured software. This is where all of you probably work and live and get paid to do, and this is where SLSA directly plays into. Then there's respond to vulnerabilities. Not everyone does this well. You can't just outsource it to a bounty program. So if you don't currently have a good vulnerability disclosure program, there are some good open source groups, working groups, creating templates to help you argue with your company about why you need to have a vulnerability disclosure program, what some good templates to use are, and then you triage that, respond to them, and then hopefully fix the bugs, or you say why you're not going to fix the bugs. So that one, if you're not doing it, please do it. And conveniently, NIST published a matrix of all the SSDF requirements, so you can actually go through and just go check if you're like me and you like doing little check marks. And actually, I was talking about earlier, it's not so scary to create the SBOM and the attestations. You have GitLab or GitHub. Man, you can just slap some of these stuff on. There's Microsoft's SPDX SBOM tool. GitLab will help you get a CycloneDX out of your build. Angular's got some stuff. If you use ActiveState for your open source stuff, we're going to give you an SBOM. And then this whole provenance thing, there's TestifySec Witness. That is open source. TestifySec is actually a company that will do non-open sourcey stuff, you know, above and beyond if you need that. But you can slap that onto GitHub or GitLab or I think possibly even Travis CI. Anyway, those guys are great. Ask them. Maybe they'll do it for your CICD. attestation, Google Cloud Build, GitHub Actions, GitLab Runner, all of these things have your back. Because like I said, it's just selling what went in, what came out, which your CICD is doing anyway. Now you've just got documentation. And if you want to go upstream, again, ActiveSafe will do your open source for you, and even do demonification. So, why we care? It's an approachable ladder to help you get closer to the SSDF. There are popular targets in the open source software community and just shared services, so it's really good to have an idea of what you're doing, what your risks are, and what maybe you should monitor. And with all the governments all over the world being more and more concerned about this, at some point you're going to have to follow some rules, so might as well have a good idea. It's just setting a common framework and language for everyone to discuss stuff. So you can say, I'm following, I'm not following at this level. It's not going to find your vulns. You still need to do your AST testing. How you get there? Again, review the requirements. Update your policies if you need to. Generate those documents. Go through the NIST matrix. Go check, 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 check. Add some more updated practices if you need to. Fingers crossed, if you've been through like your ISOs and everything, you're not that far off. But you do need to start now, because remember, June, September, they're coming. And that's it. I didn't see the red thing yet, so I think if you wanted to ask me a question, you could. Yes. Okay, so how do you avoid this being a checkbox exercise? Unfortunately, if you have very motivated individuals trying to turn it into a checkbox exercise, it's going to be hard to fight them on this. But nicely, the NIST thing, if you dig into, so you don't use their checkbox one, but you go into their details, they actually tell you in there what they're trying to get you to do and why. They don't tell you how to do it. So if you're good at arguing, you can be like, but I'm going to quote this at you, and it's a government document, and they're saying we need to do this so that we know what, and I'm going to give you an example. We know that it is a developer, one of our developers, that has contributed this in, or not, whether it was somebody who was not one of our developers. So you can kind of try and argue with them, like on the nitty-gritty. But if somebody's really determined to make it a checkbox exercise, unfortunately, they're going to kind of pull you over. Yes. All right. Any other questions? Yes. Okay, so when I say you, what kind of company should be doing it? So this is my other non-day job world. If you have anything with software in it, Internet of Things, or just pure software, it includes you. I don't care what you're making. If you know what my other project is, you would be giggling like that. So backing it up, who really should be doing it? It's going to be spread across a couple different teams. The software developers should know how their build process works. Hopefully the security team knows that there are some security scans happening in there. And then hopefully the company gives a shit about allowing consumers to report in vulnerabilities. So it's kind of spread out. And this could apply to railway stuff, because there's software in railway stuff. This could apply to, you know, baby monitors. This could apply to a large piece of software that is going to run health equipment, or it could apply to just software you're running on your machine. So it really is you, everyone. This regulation is specifically starting with anyone who supplies the government, but do you supply the VA? Who do you supply? So it's pretty widespread, but it really, in the end, supply chain, they're just now clarifying, yes, it includes software. Sorry if that was overly broad, but my belief is everyone needs to secure their stuff. So,